Hi, students. It's Mr. Starkey here. We're continuing our study of what the Bible says about pacifism and war and Christians serving in the military, and also what the Bible says about gun control and the death penalty. You guys are doing a great job on all the answers you're emailing me to the questions I'm giving you. And so, like usual, as I go through this lecture, I'm on this topic, what does the Bible say about war? I'll give you some questions that you need to answer and email those to me, okay? I'll look forward to hearing from you. So let's jump into this. We've already talked about what the Bible says about pacifism. Now let's talk about what does the Bible say about war? Well, the Bible actually has a lot to say about the war in general. You'll find words like war and battle and soldier and fight. You'll find those words hundreds of times throughout the scripture. So let's take a look at what the Old Testament says and then what the New Testament says about war. First of all, in the Old Testament, God is actually called a warrior. In Exodus chapter 15, verse 3, Yahweh is a warrior. Yahweh is his name. Also in the Old Testament, you'll find numerous times God had commanded the Israelites to conquer the Canaanites. God had set aside a promised land, which we call now Israel. But the bad guys, the Canaanites, the enemy, had occupied it. And so for the Israelites to claim their promised land, they had to go to war against the Canaanites. So God commanded the Israelites to go to battle. Also, God would at times, especially in the Old Testament, use war to judge his enemies. Numbers chapter 31, 1 Samuel chapter 17, you'll see that, where God used his people to defeat the enemy to show his enemy that he, God, was all-powerful. And then also, interestingly, David said that God taught him to fight. We know David as a king and as a poet and as a singer. Remember, he wrote about half of the Psalms. But also, don't forget that David was a warrior. He was a commander in the military. And in 2 Samuel 22, 35, he said, God trains my hands for war so that my arms can bend a bow of bronze. So in the Old Testament, there are numerous mentions of war and God calling his people at times when necessary to go to war for a good cause. Now in the New Testament, we also see the idea of war and soldiers and so forth mentioned and referred to. Interestingly, Jesus never condemned the duty of soldiers. When Jesus in the Gospels came across soldiers, he never commented negatively on any soldier that he ever came into contact with. There's a beautiful story in Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 through 12, where Jesus met this Roman military officer called a centurion. You can read the passage if you want to in Matthew 8, 5 through 12. But basically, this Roman military officer comes up to Jesus and says, my servant, who lives in a different city, is dying. And I love my servant very much, and I was wondering, Jesus, if you would heal him. And Jesus says, I will. Let's go. And then the Roman military officer, this centurion, says something surprising that even Jesus said, this is amazing. The Roman military officer, the centurion, said, well, I'm an officer, and so when I tell someone under me to go here or do that or do this, they do it. They obey my orders. And he said, I know you, Jesus, are the master of all things, and so you don't really need to come to my home where my servant is in the other city. If you'll just command it from here, I know my servant will be healed. And Jesus looked at the crowd who was around, and he said, I have not seen faith like this in all of Israel. And so it's implied that Jesus, from a distance, healed the Roman centurion's servant. And so my point in telling that story is to say, if Jesus was ever going to say, this is a man of great faith, and by the way, if you're really going to be a man of great faith, you need to get out of the military, become a pacifist or whatever. And of course, Jesus did not say that. He never spoke negatively to any soldier that he came in contact with. Also, the Apostle Paul used imagery of fighting and war, soldiers, battle armor to describe the Christian life. You're probably familiar with the battle armor in Ephesians 6, right? The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the sword of the Spirit, the belt of truth, and the feet shod and prepared for for spreading the gospel. And he also described the Christian life as being Christian soldiers, meaning that, you know, we are in a spiritual war. So Paul used a lot of imagery, a lot of military and war imagery to describe the Christian life. We talked about this a lot when we asked, what does the New Testament say about pacifism? We learned that a basic responsibility of the government is to restrain and punish those who do evil, right? Criminals and so forth. That was in Romans chapter 13. Well, it's not just restraining and punishing those who do evil from within the country. It's also included in that passage in Romans 13 is the idea of it's the government's responsibility to defend the nation against foreign attackers from the outside who would seek to kill and conquer and subjugate people in that nation. And do you remember Paul even mentioned in that Romans 13 passage about how the government bears the sword? And we said the sword is a killing instrument. And we said that's one of the verses that leads us to conclude the Bible does condone the death penalty, capital punishment. But it also implies here that military force, meaning the sword, must be used at times to defend the nation. So that is a basic responsibility of a God-ordained government, is to protect the nation from countries that would try to conquer it. So the New Testament has quite a bit to say about soldiers and battle and war and those kinds of things. And also remember we mentioned this, that when Jesus returns as the righteous warrior at his second coming, Revelation 19 says his conquest will be violent, bloody, gory, and actually merciless. In fact, scripture talks about very vivid description how birds will eat the flesh of the enemy soldiers, and it's just going to be a crazy time. You've heard of the Battle of Armageddon. Well, that's what's being described here. So again, the point here is to say that the Bible recognizes that soldiering and battles and war and so forth are realities. And as we've already established, neither the Old nor the New Testaments condone, support, or promote pacifism. So I love this quote by General Robert E. Lee. You know who he was, right? During the Civil War, he commanded the Confederate Army. He was also a follower of Christ. And he has this quote, "It is good that war is so terrible, or we should grow too fond of it." And the point is to say that war is one of the most dreadful events that can be inflicted on people. We know war results in destruction of life and property, poverty, widows, orphans. It results in emotional and psychological stress. You've heard of PTSD, and you can see in that soldier's helmet the post-traumatic stress syndrome. Symptoms, anxiety, depression, trauma, grief, rage, even substance abuse and suicide. So the point is to say that the Bible doesn't speak well of war because it recognizes, and we all know from our experience, that war is one of the most dreadful events that can be inflicted on people. So war is never a good thing, but sometimes it is a necessary thing. Sometimes the only way to keep evil people, whether it's the Nazis of World War II or terrorists today, the only way sometimes to keep evil people from doing great harm to the innocent is by going to war. So the Bible does not allow war in general, like you can go to war for just any reason, but the Bible does recognize that at times war can be the right thing to do. This is called having a just war, just meaning right. So a just war or a justified or a right war is one that's waged on behalf of justice. It's not fought for just any reason. It has a just, righteous cause. And of course, the goal of a just war is peace. So there's something called the just war theory that I want to talk about as we approach the end of my lecture here. The just war theory is actually rooted in the Christian worldview. It's rooted, it's founded upon Bible principles. And the just war theory provides guidelines to help a nation prevent any unnecessary violence and mayhem. You know, mayhem means like chaos. So there's going to be violence, there's going to be chaos, mayhem, whenever there's a war. But the just war theory, founded upon the Christian worldview and within biblical principles, helps reduce as much as possible any unnecessary, you know, violence and mayhem. So here are six guidelines that bring war under the rule of justice. And I want you to notice with each of these six, there is a Bible principle that goes with it. Number one, there must be a just cause. And the question that we want to answer before we go to war is, number one, is the reason for going to war a morally right cause, like defense of a nation? Romans 13:3 says, do what is right, and you will receive approval from the God-appointed government, right? So first of all, we want to make sure that the cause for going to war is a morally right cause. Number two, there must be just intention, a right intention. We're asking this question before we go to war. Is the intention of going to war to protect justice and righteousness rather than simply to rob another nation or pillage, steal from them, or destroy, you know, another nation? Proverbs 21:2 says, every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the heart. In other words, the Lord looks at the intention. So number one, is there a just cause for going to war? Number two, is there a good, a right intention? Number three, war must be the last resort. It's got to be our last chance, not our first choice, okay? War has to be the last resort after all other methods to resolve the conflict have failed. So before we go to war, we're going to ask this question. Have all other reasonable means of resolving the conflict been exhausted? Maybe we can put financial and economic sanctions on the country that's threatening us, or maybe we can go to our allies and just intimidate the enemy into not going into war because they see that it's us and our allies that they would be up against. So the question we're asking here before we go to war is, have all other reasonable means of resolving the conflict been exhausted? Of course, if the answer to this is yes, then the only thing left to defend our nation for a just cause is to go to war. Romans 12:18 says, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. So again, I love that verse, Romans 12:18, because it's saying on an individual basis or on a national level, it's up to us to do everything we can to live at peace with other people or other countries. But if it reaches a point where they refuse to live at peace with us, then we may have to go to war. Number four of the six, there must be a formal declaration of war. Here's the question we're asking. Has the war been declared not simply by a renegade band within the nation, but by a recognized competent authority within the nation? What this means is that you or I, as just citizens of our country, can't personally, individually, legally declare war on a nation. Okay, if you're mad at Canada for whatever reason, then you can't just decide our country's going to go to war with Canada just because you decide that, okay? Romans 13:1 gives us this guidance. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. So only a government with proper authority can declare war. An individual cannot declare war on another country. Number five, proportionate means are used. We're asking this question. Will the good results that come from a victory in war be significantly greater than the harm and loss that will inevitably come with pursuing the war? So in other words, our question is, what's the damage? What's the fallout? If we go to war, will the victory that we gain be significantly greater than what it's going to cost? Okay, Romans 12:21 says, don't be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So we're going to make sure that we don't overreact if we're attacked or one of our military bases are attacked or an embassy is attacked in another country. We want to make sure that our response is proportional. And then number six, non-combatants are immune. Of course, a non-combatant would be anyone who is not involved in the war. So the question we ask before we go to war is, insofar as it is feasible, in the successful pursuit of a war, is adequate care being taken to prevent harm to non-combatants? And by the way, that would include POWs, you know, prisoners of war, and casualties. So we're not going to bomb a hospital that has enemy soldiers that are recovering, casualties there. we're going to treat the prisoners of war that we take in a humane way. And so we're going to make sure also that we don't harm, again, non-combatants, you know, citizens and others who are not involved in the war. In other words, we're going to aim at soldiers, military participants only. Exodus 23:7 says, do not kill the innocent and righteous. So these are six guidelines rooted in biblical principles, rooted in the Christian worldview, that help us make sure that if we have no other choice, if we have to answer you know, yes to all of these six guideline questions, we have no other choice but to go to war, we're going to make sure that we do everything we can to reduce the violence and the mayhem that will come with war. So here's some questions I want you to answer, okay? There are seven of them, and I'm really interested to see how you answer these. Number one, how might the just war theory be different if it were not rooted in the Christian worldview? Remember, those six guidelines for a just war are rooted in the Christian worldview. So what if a country went to war, but it didn't have the just war theory to guide them? What might a just war theory look like if it wasn't guided by the Christian worldview? Number two, of those six guidelines of the just war theory, choose two that you think are the most important, and then explain why you think those two are the most important. Number three, do you think maintaining a strong military force in the United States glorifies God? Why or why not? And again, I want you to just give me your opinion. Don't answer how you think I want you to answer. About the only way you're going to lose points on any of these is if you just don't answer it. I want to hear your opinion and what you think. Put some thought into it for number three. Number four, do you think the United States should have nuclear weapons? Why or why not? Number five, the United States Department of Defense logo is on the Just War Theory slides. Did you notice that? If I back up, you'll see them on each one of those slides. So what I want you to do is do a little research, just Google it, and write four facts about the Department of Defense. Four facts about the Department of Defense. Number six, would you be willing to fight in a war to defend your nation against attack, even if it required killing soldiers who were attacking your country? Why or why not? If you say yes, tell me why. If you say no, tell me why not. Again, I'm not going to count points off, you know, for your answer. I just want you to answer, and I want to see what you think and defend why you think what you think. And then number seven, do you think God would approve of how you answer number six, why or why not? Okay, I look forward to hearing your answers. God bless you guys. And again, as always, I'm flexible with these due dates. I know you guys are super busy. And again, you are doing a great job with all of this e-learning and stuff. Proud of you. Just communicate with me, okay? If you need some extra time, just let me know, okay? I love you guys. Have a great day. Goodbye.